So you get a real experience that kids care about. They want to do well in the game, so they try hard. And this is probably no surprise to parents or teachers, right? When kids actually care about a game, they can sustain attention for incredibly long periods of time. And I have data to show how long they can play a game, and they're functioning at peak performance. That's why you get these rapid gains in fact fluency. They don't care so much about flashcards. If that was all that was the operative principle, that would probably be enough. But there's something else that's happening here. Because they're playing a game that's actually has objectives, that they have to use those parts of their brain that, you know, ultimately you want in your classroom, they have to learn how to pull math facts in seamlessly while they're attending to game objectives. That's exactly what you want ultimately happening in your classroom. That there's a kid who's learning how to add fractions with unlike denominators, and they're just pulling in those 14 math facts. Okay, so let me just give you the quick, it's a lot easier to show a video game than prattle on about it, so. Okay, so this is our game called Quick Slither. And in order to play the game, you're that orbiting thing in the center, which becomes a snake as you start answering math facts. You'll see how it works. What I'm doing right now is when I want to go in a certain direction, I'm typing in the answer to the math fact. Okay, so if I want to go down here now, I type 56. I'm not pressing enter or anything. I just type the numbers and off I go. And you notice that when I go over those crystals there that you'll see in a second. Here, let's see if I can navigate over to one without dying. Here we go. Okay, now I get longer every time I go over one. But I have to keep avoiding that chaser. And as the game goes on, everything gets faster. There's going to be two chasers and three chasers. And so you can see that, first of all, this is a real game, right? There's a real objective. It's fun. I'll probably want to try to beat my high score. It's not just, you know, flashcards with a pretty surface on them. This is a genuine game that's going to engage the kids' attention and get progressively more difficult. The other thing that's happening is that their working memory is being taxed by the demands of the game, right? Something is chasing me. I have to figure out how to navigate around and avoid the enemies. In other games, there's animals to free and jewels to collect and things of that nature. So I'm thinking actively about the game objectives. And in order to be successful at the game, I have to keep pulling out math facts from my long-term memory, right? So I have to have them fully automatized. This is exactly what we want happening in the classroom, right? Because we're teaching them a new procedure that's novel to them, something like adding fractions with unlike denominators. And you want to be having them focusing on the procedure, knowing about the rules, where they are in the process, all the while pulling out those 14 or more math facts that they need without even thinking about them, right? And you've probably seen this in your kids when they're playing video games at home. At the beginning, when they're learning something, they have to focus their attention on it. But then after a while, it becomes automatic and they can save the universe while having a conversation with you at the same time. Ultimately, that's what you want with math facts, right? So you can be confident that if a kid is successful in a task like this, where their working memory is loaded, that they're going to be able to duplicate this in your classroom. Oh, let me just kill myself here. Or just quit out. Okay. Now, you think that's a pedestrian game? You tried when there's two or three things chasing you. This is a very, very hard game. I can tell you that when we developed this game at Explore Learning, productivity crashed for a few days as all the developers started playing this game. It's very addictive. And by the way, if you want to, I believe we're doing contests at this conference. If you come down to our booth, we're at 319, and so you can see, you can play the game for yourself and get a sense for it. It won't be adaptive because it doesn't know you at that point, but at least you get a sense for how a game like that works. But the key thing there, a fun game, you know, like it's a game, there's actual things to do, so the kids persevere and try to do their best. They want to get a high score. But the more important instructional thing that's happening under the hood there is that to move around, I need to be focusing. Where's the ship? Where do I want to go? Where's the jewel? And I need to answer math facts in order to get that. I need to be pulling them smoothly out of that retrieval box. Again, that's what we want in the classroom. That's the last mile. If a kid is successful in these games, they'll be successful in that capacity in your classroom.